Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the November regular meeting of the Hoboken Board of Education. I now call this meeting to order. Mr. Moffitt?
I'll read a statement of compliance. This meeting is being held in conformity to the Open Publics Meeting Act. Proper public notice of this meeting was published in the local newspapers on November 12, 2016, and November 13, 2016. If any board member or member of the public in attendance believes that this meeting is in violation of the Open Publics Meeting Act, the Hoboken Board of Education requests that they make a statement at this time. The board wishes to make those in attendance aware that this meeting is being recorded on video and will be broadcast by the board at a later date on cable television channel 77 and Fios channel 46. The full meeting recording is also made available on board docs, which can be accessed through the district's homepage. The Hoboken Board of Education is committed to preserving the decorum of the public process and is mindful that we live in an electronic age of computers, cell phones, and other electronic communication devices. Nevertheless, we respectfully request that all meeting participants kindly silence their electronic devices during the course of the meeting, and if use of the device is necessary, we ask that you please leave the meeting room if you need to conduct personal business. If you could please rise for the salute to the flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
And Mr. Moffitt, the roll call, please.
Yes, sir. Ms. Angley?
Here.
Mr. Biancamano?
Present.
Ms. Evans?
Here.
Dr. Gold?
Here.
Mr. Madigan?
Here.
Mr. McNamara?
Here.
Ms. Montgomery?
Here.
Ms. Sobolov?
Here.
And Ms. Klufel?
Here. We start each meeting with our Students of the Month recognitions. Mr. Fitzhugh.
Good evening.
Good evening.
We're going to begin with Joseph F. Brandt Primary School. Our first recipient is Raphael Kim, first grade. Raphael was nominated by Alyssa Correa, his first grade teacher. Raphael has seamlessly transitioned into first grade. He is hardworking and a pleasure to have in his class. It has been a pleasure to have Raphael in my class, as per Ms. Correa. He is intelligent, friendly, hardworking, polite, and determined. He is a true role model for the other students in this school. His calm demeanor is second to none. This is Raphael's second time being nominated as Brandt Student of the Month. His hard work and dedication to learning cannot go unnoticed. Raphael is a polite student who works hard and is always willing to help a friend in need. When speaking to Raphael, Ms. Correa writes the following. Raphael enjoys playing with Legos. I like Legos too. You know how tall my Legos really are? They're like really, really tall. Drawing the color red and playing games with his family. His favorite foods are hot dogs and pizza. In school, his favorite subjects are science and technology. He hopes to be an engineer when he grows up. He loves coming to school because of our science classes and recess time. He believes he has been selected Students of the Month because he has really good manners. I think you do too. Raphael states, in school you should not focus on talking. Instead of talking to your friends, watch in front of you when you're walking to school. It's very important. Let's give a big hand to Raphael for being the Brandt recipient Student of the Month. I have something for you. Our next recipient from Calabro Elementary is Brianna Ziff, grade 5. I'm going to read what the school presented on Brianna's behalf. Brianna is an outstanding fifth grade student from Ms. Leone's homeroom who deserves to be selected as Collaborative School's October District Student of the Month. She is conscientious, cooperative, motivated, kind, and achieves her goals through hard work and dedication. Brianna has all the qualities of an exemplary student, is a great asset to our school. Dr. Vespignani quotes, Brianna is a well-mannered student who demonstrates kindness every day. She's extremely focused and is a positive influence on her peers. Ms. Leone quotes, keep reaching for the stars, they are yours for the taking. Brianna has been a participant of our gifted and talented program for the past 2 years. Brianna loves music and is a talented musician who plays the piano, violin, and cello. She also enjoys gymnastics and cheerleading. Brianna expresses gratitude for this recognition, and she states that she will always try to learn great new things. She is proud to be a member of the Hoboken Board of Education. Brianna quotes, there's no elevator to success. You have to take the stairs to success. Mm-hmm. Brianna is a well-rounded student who deserves to be praised for her hard work and dedication both in and out of school. It is the honor of Ms. Leone and Dr. Vespignani and the school community to honor Brianna Ziff to be the Outstanding Student of the Month from Collabro Elementary. Well, Brianna, before we give you the award, I want to read your statement again because I think it's really important, okay? Brianna is an outstanding fifth grade student from Ms. Leone's homeroom who deserves to be selected as Collabro School's October District Student of the Month. She is cooperative, motivated, kind, and achieves her goals through hard work and dedication. Brianna has all the qualities of exemplary student, is a great asset to our school. Dr. Vespignani, your principal, quotes, Brianna is a well-mannered student who demonstrates kindness each day. She's extremely focused and is a positive influence on her peers. Ms. Leone, your fifth grade teacher, states, keep reaching for the stars. They are yours for the taking. Brianna has been a participant of our gifted and talented program for the past 2 years. Brianna loves music and is a talented musician who plays piano, violin, and cello. She also enjoys gymnastics and cheerleading. In the future, Brianna wants to attend culinary school and plans to visit Paris when she's 16 years old in preparation of fulfilling her dreams. Brianna expresses gratitude for this recognition. I always try my best to learn new things. I'm so proud to be a part of the Hoboken Public School District at Collabro School. Brianna quotes, there's no elevator to success. You have to take the stairs. I like your quote. I think it's pretty awesome. Brianna is well-rounded. A student who deserves to be praised for her hard work and dedication both in and out of school. It is my honor for Ms. Leone to nominate Brianna as the Collabro School's October District Student of the Month. Let's give Brianna a big round of applause. We're so very proud of all your accomplishments. Congratulations. We're very proud. Our next recipient is from Thomas G. Connors Elementary School, Josiah Boyd, grade 2. Josiah Boyd is a second grade student at Thomas G. Connors Elementary School. Josiah was nominated as the October Student of the Month by her classroom teacher, Ms. Romanowski. Ms. Romanowski nominated Josiah because of her strong effort she puts forth each and every single day and the eagerness she learns as she displays to learn every day in school. Josiah also has a bubbly personality and caring nature towards others. Now I can attest to that. Josiah sets an example for other students each and every single day, both academically and behaviorally. She shows a genuine interest for all subject matter and does not back down when faced with a challenge. Josiah is an active class participant and truly puts her best effort into everything she completes. Josiah is an asset to the Thomas G. Connors Elementary School family because she embodies the Connors Cares statement. Commit to learning, acting responsibly, respecting everyone, effort matters, and soaring to success. Josiah acts responsibly by making positive behavioral choices throughout the day. She shows effort by completing her work slowly and thoughtfully and paying attention to detail to ensure that it can be the best that it can possibly be. She soars to success by asking great questions and seeking opportunities to extend her learning forward. Some of Josiah's hobbies outside of school includes playing on her iPad and playing softball. In school, Josiah enjoys art and science. After completing high school, Josiah hopes to attend college and become a teacher. I think that's pretty awesome. She would love to be a teacher because she likes to help people learn new and exciting things. Josiah feels proud to win Student of the Month because she feels so proud of herself and knows her family would be proud of her too. Let's give Josiah a big round of applause this evening. Such a great honor. Our Wallace Elementary Student of the Month, Genevieve Fink. Genevieve is a fourth grade student from Mrs. DeCastro's class, is proudly recognized as the Wallace School Student of the Month. Genevieve possesses all the attributes of an outstanding student. She is self-motivated, responsible, kind, and most importantly, a leader. She comes to school every day with a smile on her face and eager to learn. She gives 100% every single day. It's an absolute pleasure to have as a student. As Mr. Castro states, I cannot think of a more deserving student to receive this honor. Genevieve is a fantastic student and a young lady who serves as an excellent role model to all around her. Genevieve is a great representation of our Wallace community. She is hardworking and kind and is always willing to take an academic challenge. We are all so very proud of her, and we know that she will continue to excel and be a great example to our students. And Mr. Shannon said that, so I think it's pretty cool that he knows you very well. Genevieve has completed all assessments as required by the district and has excelled. She has tested with the Johns Hopkins Gifted and Talented Program, where she takes part in the language arts class. Ms. DeCastro is looking forward to a productive year with her and is sure that Genevieve will continue to flourish. Outside of school, Genevieve keeps herself very busy. She loves to act. She takes part in the Miles Square Theater and also participates in dance classes. She enjoys soccer and is currently learning how to play the clarinet. Her favorite subject is reading, and she hopes to attend either Juilliard, NYU, or Michigan State someday. When she grows up, she wants to be an actress on Broadway because she loves going to Broadway shows. If that doesn't work out, she's a backup plan. She wants to be the general manager of her favorite hockey team, the New York Rangers.
Yeah.
All right. According to Genevieve, I'm small, but I pack a big punch. Congratulations to Genevieve Fink, the Wallace student, school student of the month. Wait a minute. Next, we have Hoboken Middle School. The recipient for the October District Student of the Month, Olivia Olney. Nominated by Mr. Taglieri, Olivia is an outstanding student. She presents all work in a timely and accurate manner. She's extremely cooperative and is kind and courteous to students and staff alike. She has a strong desire to succeed and takes great pride in being a Hoboken Middle School student. Her efforts in class, in and out of class rather, indicate an extremely bright future. She is a definitive asset to our school community. Olivia has been an honor roll student throughout her academic career. When asked for one word to describe herself, she says optimistic. Her favorite subject is ELA. She really enjoys learning about literature and exploring different genres. She is both academically and personally a bright student. She always has a smile or a kind word to say to others. Her favorite book is Wonder, and she chooses kind. Ms. Donnelly said that Olivia is extremely well-rounded student. Her positive attitude is infectious. When asked how she feels about the District Student of the Month award, she said, "That's pretty cool." Olivia has many interests, including photography, which she practices daily. Her future goals are to attend Johns Hopkins University and become a graphic designer. We have no doubt she will achieve any goal set for herself. She likes the quote by Benjamin Franklin, "I didn't fail the test, I just found 100 ways to do it wrong." Olivia feels this shows perseverance. Congratulations to Olivia. Let's give her a big round of applause this evening. Hoboken High School Student of the Month is Angeline Belosi. Let's give Angeline a big round of applause this evening. Good evening. Nominated by Ms. Tank. Mrs. Tank said that Angeline is very respectful. She is always punctual, on task, and adds positivity to the classroom environment. She has an outstanding attitude. Principal Pinky Pietra said that Angeline is a spirited young lady who has hit the ground running as a freshman. She's involved in athletics, clubs, and still maintains excellent grades. Just recently, she volunteered her time as a student representative at Open House. She's extremely well-rounded, who takes advantage of everything that high school has to offer. She is kind to her friends and to those surrounded around her, and has made her first marking period a huge success. Angeline is a leader and a role model for the students of Hoboken High School. She leads by example. Her attitude, grades, ambition, and tenacity make her a successful student. She is a leader amongst the class of 2019. She's also a member of the varsity volleyball team and an active member of the Harvard Model Congress, student council treasurer, and the class of 2019 secretary. Wow, that is pretty good, wow. Angeline likes to spend her time with friends and family, playing sports and drawing. Angeline's post-secondary plans include applying to college and studying pre-medical sciences. When notified about the award, Angeline said, "I'm very happy to be viewed as a model student at Hoboken High School." And she wants to thank Ms. Tank and the administration for nominating her. Let's please stand and give Angeline a round of applause this evening. This concludes this portion of our board meeting. Let's please again give all of our recipients a big round of applause. They exemplify the true essence of our school district.
Normally, we take a brief recess to allow families and students to quietly leave and go home and do some reading. But I think tonight we'd like to try something different. If the students are still here and their families, could we come down front as we go into a recess for a quick group photo of everyone together? Would you mind? Peter, I was going to make Peter the photographer. But he's
Got in, guys.
Thank you. All right, thank you. We'll resume now. Next item of business is the reports to the board. We start with the superintendent's report.
Okay, so this evening I have two formal reports. One is reporting out of EBVRS data for periods 1 and 2, which actually takes us from last July through December, and then December through June 30th. So it's periods 1 and 2, and we're always 1 year behind when we report out this EBVRS data. That's typically what happens. That data gets reported out and is required to be reported out by January of the following school year. So with that being said, what I would like to do is just give these to the board. Couple that way, couple this way. Okay, so what's being distributed to you right now is just periods 1 and periods 2. It's front and back sided, just so you can see. But to make it a little bit easier, I wanted to also provide you with some longitudinal data regarding EBVRS. And what we've put together for you is an 11-year trend, just so you have the idea of what was going on in the district from 2006-2007 through 2015-2016. So, take that. Take that. Okay, so what you see in front of you on the Department of Education handout are the categories that we report out for EBVRS, which include violence, vandalism, weapons, substance abuse, and HIV. So the other thing that I wanted to draw your attention to is the longitudinal data, just so you get an easier snapshot to take a look at it. So you can see where we were in 2005-2006. I think I've said this before, the category violence includes everything from scuffle, pushing, poking, anything that evokes some sort of argument or physical contact between students. Vandalism includes anything from spray painting to writing on desks to writing on school walls to purposefully breaking something. That all kind of falls within the vandalism category. The weapons category for the state of New Jersey has changed over the years. Prior to 2 years ago, that category included everything from toy guns, toy weapons, anything along those lines that could be construed as being dangerous. The Department of Education changed the definition of that category. Replica guns that do not project anything, that are considered toys, they are not reported, but they are, it's highly recommended that school districts inform parents the dangers of having children bring those types of toys to school. So one of the things that we do on an annual basis in our elementary schools is to make sure that children understand that anything that would be construed as an item that could potentially harm someone seriously or even mildly is highly discouraged from being brought to school. And that includes a stick that is picked up on the way to school to something that could be converted to a slingshot to a bow and arrow, anything along those lines. And then substance abuse entails any incident in which a child is sent out for testing and is deemed positive. Now, one of the things that I think is important to inform the board of is that virtually every high school has a contract with a local health provider for the purpose of testing students that are viewed as potentially being under the influence. One of the things that school districts are finding, though, is that testing does not include and has not historically included synthetic drugs or anything along those lines. So what we've done in our school district is that we've asked our provider to actually expand the battery of testing, because one of the things we want to make sure of is not necessarily, obviously we're working educationally to ensure that any kind of incidences of substance abuse decrease, but we want to make sure that we have an accurate picture of a child that may potentially be struggling or needs help. So as a result of that, it's better for us, we feel, to expand the battery and include everything, including synthetic marijuana, et cetera. So we have done that. So you can see from 2005, 2006 through 2015, we've reduced the number of incidences of violence by over 50%. Our vandalism numbers are down to zero. Our weapons number was at zero last year, and we had three instances of substance abuse reported as well. So what the state report does is it totals the incident numbers, and it includes HIB confirmed cases as well. So you'll see that HIB numbers didn't actually begin to be tallied by the state of New Jersey until 2013. So that's the reason why you don't see them earlier. But this should give you a pretty good perspective of the incidences that we've had to report through EVVRS. I can also assure the board that the district doesn't take these incidences lightly. And we report, we err on the side of caution, and we actually report everything. When it comes down to an issue that we are not sure of, we specifically put it in writing and send it to the Department of Education so that we can get a response back in writing, so we know for sure whether or not it's something that's reportable or not reportable. So that occurs as well. So if any board members have any questions regarding this, we've also taken this information after tonight's meeting. It's been given to our district website coordinator to post the information on the website as well. We'll include the longitudinal and historical data so the public can view that as well. But does any board member have a question about the incidences, the trends, anything along those lines? You'll see underneath it also, this report also requires us to disaggregate the data based on student population and who the victims are, who the perpetrators are, et cetera. So we have a better understanding of whether or not there's pockets that we need to address. Anything?
I think it's great to see that the trend is heading in the right direction. I know you weren't here, you know, early on when there were more incidences, but can you attribute us heading in the right direction to anything in particular, policy change or?
I definitely think that the policies that are in place, including some of the consequences, have definitely deterred some of the activities. This year we are trying something a little different, and we're kind of slowly weaving in a preventative justice type program where students are actually being asked to not just take a consequence but turn the incident into a learning experience, not only for themselves, but also to enhance the school community. So we've had students put together presentations, actually deliver them, and almost convert from being someone who was potentially involved in an altercation to someone who potentially could be viewed as a peer leader. So that's something we're doing this year, but we're making sure that it's a fine balance between when that is applied and when specific consequences are applied, because both incidences definitely require us to look at that logically before it's enforced. I also think that we will see the trend continue to decrease. Sometimes a lot of people look at this and they think they attribute, when they see violence, vandalism, et cetera, to the high school, right? Because you hear the term violence and you think older children. But in all actuality, the numbers that are reported for violence and vandalism holistically and statewide include children from 5 years old all the way up. So potential scuffle on the playground between two children that might not have all their tools in the box sharpened in terms of good decision making, they would be included in this particular report as well. But I do believe that we will continue to see this number decrease based on the work we're doing to kind of enhance climate and culture in the schools. At the high school, I think adding two deans of students and programs is helping tremendously establish relationships between kids and adults. So they are absolutely thinking twice before they act, because they do know that they have more adults to go to. So I think that's powerful. And I also think that having the deans of students and programs that are not linked to an administrative title is also positive and helping. And the reason that I say that is because they serve more as social and emotional coaches than they do as consequence givers. So I think that's helping as well. I also think that the addition of guidance staff, adding an additional guidance counselor at Wallace School and a shared counselor at the two other elementary schools is definitely helping as well. So I do feel positive that we will continue to see the trend decrease. Good.
Thank you.
Peter, you have.
Yeah, just to follow up, I think the superintendent answered mainly my questions. Dr. Johnson, you did say that this report encompasses the whole district, correct? It's not just one school or another.
That's correct.
And I think you mentioned something very interesting when you said most people would look at the high school and think that most of the incidents were there. And you wouldn't say that, correct? You think it's blanketed across the district? And then going forward, and I know you answered this, We do see a declining trend, but we want to get this number as close to zero as possible.
Correct.
So, and I think you mentioned with the Dean of Students, the disciplinarians in the high school, that we're going to continue to see these numbers drop, hopefully. I was just curious, in terms of enrollment of students, do you feel that there's been less students and that's why we have less incidents, or do you just feel that it's because of these newer administrators that you're adding, or it's these new programs that you're adding that are keeping it to a low level, or the numbers low?
Okay, so I think actually that's a really good question. One of the things that we tend to see when there's reporting on in incidences or categories like this is that we tend to see the same children appear as those that are typically either involved or initiating a conflict. And so I actually don't necessarily think that it's linked directly to enrollment or size of the student body. But I do think what it does is it helps us and it gives us a better understanding of if there is a small population of kids that are really struggling with decision making, some sort of potential anger management, something issues that are maybe larger than what we would expect a typical student to come to school with. This report gives us the opportunity to really look at what the trends are, who the students are, and design programs for smaller groups of students. So I don't see it as an enrollment type issue, but we'll certainly keep our eye on whether or not there's any correlation between the two.
Thank you.
Anybody else on this side? Okay. Over here? Dr. Gold, over there?
Okay. Thank you. All right, so before I jump into the next portion, what I do want to report out are a few items that are going on in the district that I think are critical for the board to know. So from the last time we met, I'm not sure whether or not we had the opportunity to report out on the showcase of excellence that we had at the high school. We had a number of parents and students from schools across Hoboken. It was really nice to see so many families. And even the surrounding area. So many families come to see the school. I think the feedback that we received that was most positive was that the programs that were presented were both impressive and innovative. People seemed to be very interested in some of our high school programs, such as Classrooms Without Walls, the Rutgers Pre-Med program, Project Lead the Way at the high school, our personal growth period. There were a whole host of things that they were pretty interested in. But I think the other portion of it was we did this a little differently this year, and we decided to let the kids lead a lot of the conversations. And our students certainly didn't disappoint. They represented the school extremely well. They represented themselves extremely well. And they were pleasant, and they engaged both parents, families, and potential students as well. We hope to take this concept of showcase of excellence and expand it so that it's not just a new version of a high school open house, but potentially an event that the whole district can actually be involved in, so that parents, family members, community members could come on in and see what's going on with all of our students in all of our schools, and to show off the talents of our faculty as well. So we've also had a number of PTO meetings, special education parent meetings. We've had some HECAC meeting as well, and also some Ed Foundation events that I think are notable enough to say it's really powerful when we see parents come together, guardians come together for meetings, and also to kind of show their interest and their commitment to the district. And those events, including what I heard was a nice Ed Foundation event on Friday night, a yoga event, went extremely well. It's powerful. It shows that our parents are really engaged in what's going on in the district. From a professional development standpoint, I do think it's important to just report out. I'm sure Ms. Evans is also going to report out on this. We have been engaged in a lot of professional development lately. So coming off the beginning of school and some of the professional development that happened over the summer, just want to make sure that everyone understands that our 6th, 7th, and 8th grade teachers are deeply engaged in math training, professional development training, not necessarily on PARC or anything associated with that, but more on the idea and the concepts behind the 8 foundational mathematical principles, really more from the perspective of helping our teachers be able to communicate math as a language, a skill, and concepts, as opposed to just being able to answer questions on a standardized test. Although we do believe that it will tremendously help our faculty and our children as well. We have some dyslexia identification training that's coming up within the next month and a half. All of our kindergarten through second grade teachers, including some third grade faculty as well, will be trained in identifying signs of and displays of dyslexia among students. It's a state-required training, so all of our teachers will receive that in those grade levels. We also had a professional development day last Tuesday, which was extremely successful, very engaging, and it highlighted a lot of the core areas that we're focused on: authentic literacy, designing effective lessons, the growth mindset, a whole host of topics and ideas. And our teachers not only had the opportunity to participate in action labs, but also in think tanks. So that was pretty powerful. I do want to mention that our kids in the district are gearing up for a lot of great things that are on the horizon. As you know, our holiday concerts, our winter concerts are coming up, so the kids are preparing for that. We also have students at the high school that are engaged in a whole series of events and also some fundraising for the upcoming Classroom Without Walls trip. And if I'm not mistaken, that trip is to London and Paris. So the kids are really excited about that. Some of our high school students were engaged with a teacher over the last couple weeks in the Technology Student Association Cyber Patriot competition. And that was kind of exciting. And along those same lines, as a result of our Project Lead the Way program, we are connecting a lot more with the Technology Student Association, which offers a range of competitions and learning experiences for our kids. So in addition to Cyber Patriot meetings that the kids have in those competitions, we are also launching the monthly mathematical challenges, so our kids will be engaged in those as well. I also think it's important just to report out that all of our schools have been registered for the countywide spelling bee, and we are also going to be including our middle school this year in that spelling bee as well, so we're excited about that. Our high school math club has been participating in math challenges and competitions, and today I received notification from the high school math teacher that went to the principal and then came to me that our high school students almost tripled their scores in the last online math competition. So we're really excited about that. The kids at the high school in math are working extremely, extremely hard. Our students that are involved in Harvard Model Congress are gearing up and getting themselves ready to go to San Francisco for that particular trip. But I also think it's important for the board to know that that club has also almost tripled in size, and as a result of it, I think that the moderators came up with a really good way to engage as many students as possible. So while a select team goes and competes in San Francisco for Harvard Model Congress, when they come back in the spring, they are going to then shift gears a little bit and begin preparing the students in that club for Model UN, which takes place at St. Peter's University. And what will happen is a separate team of students that were not involved in the San Francisco trip will actually participate in Model UN and compete there. So we're really excited about that. And then the last thing that I do want to report out is that we have, for the first time, middle school girls basketball team and a couple middle school boys basketball teams that are going to be competing in the local Hoboken Recreation League. So you might think, why is that so exciting? Well, it actually is very exciting because we have finally begun to establish a middle school identity, and this is actually the first sports teams that are being kind of formulated and designed in partnership, almost in a shared partnership with the city's rec league. So our kids will be competing against kids from other schools in Hoboken who have traditionally and typically competed with their school. So our kids are beyond excited about it, and I can't wait to see them play. And then lastly, our Passport to Learning registration for students in grades K to 2 has begun. It started yesterday, it happened today, and will also occur tomorrow. I cannot begin to tell you how many children have signed up already for it, and it was so much smoother in terms of the registration process. We did it both online and in person and gave parents the opportunity to participate in either simultaneously, so that there was no disadvantage to someone who did not have technology. Everybody had the same opportunity to enroll. Every child will have a spot in a class no matter what and can continue to participate. And the program itself is beginning to really take shape and take hold. We had a meeting with the parent advisory group and kind of hashed out some challenges that we were still having with the program. But what was really nice was that some of the recommendations that the parents put forward in that meeting, we were able to kind of convert. And as a result, we have kids that are going to be participating in a chess competition through Alpha Minds in Jersey City coming up in an upcoming weekend. We have children who are participating in our Mandarin Chinese program and our Spanish program who will be present at Wallace School's International Night. They're kind of excited about that. We also have some dance and music performances that are coming up that are all stemming from the Passport to Learning program. We're preparing for our students that are participating in debate to begin competitions as well. And we certainly can't wait for our first edition of the Journey magazine to come out, which is completely kid created. And I think everyone's gonna be really impressed when they see what that looks like. So those are the things that are going on in the district. And now I need to just shift gears and go back from some state reporting to some interesting things, and now I need to go back to state reporting for a minute. So what I need to do right now is provide the Board of Education with some information regarding CUSAC. And CUSAC is a monitoring process that's done by the Department of Education. It happens every 3 years, and I think it's important that the board knows, as well as the public, that it's on the third year that the monitoring occurs. And what happens is, in the 2 years in between, or I should say the fourth year, in the 2 years in between, the district will receive interim reviews. So you will have a standard score at the time of the first CUSAC report, and then there will be interim visits, and then you go through CUSAC all over again, and then you have interim visits, and then you go through CUSAC all over again. So typically, that process is fairly time-consuming on the first round, and it's a little more review-oriented afterwards. So what I did was I put together a little history of CUSAC for the board, and I do want board members to know that in addition to the years that we actually do go through CUSAC, every year we also have to submit something called a statement of assurance. So in your board docs, Board of Ed members, you will see something called a statement of assurance, and then you will also see something called DPRs. So the statement of assurance is what you actually, as a district, we fill out every single year. And then what you see in the more kind of voluminous packet is the district performance review, which are called the DPRs. And this guides the actual CUSAC process. So we'll start with just the statement of assurances, because they actually are different topics within. They all fall within the same umbrellas, but the point totals are in different categories, okay? So it is possible that you can have one score in your SOA and you can have a different score in your DPR, because they're two different, the content is different in both. So on our SOA for this year, having gone through all the questions, the backup reporting, et cetera. The way our SOA reports out for this year is that in instruction and program, our SOA scores are 100%. In fiscal management, our SOA score is 80%. In governance, the SOA score is 100%. In personnel, it's 100%. And in operations, it's 100%. These are kind of, if you review them, these are somewhat checkoff-oriented tasks that the district has to complete. When we get to the actual DPR, I want to talk a little bit about the discrepancy between the SOA in instruction and program and then the DPR in instruction and program, because some people might say, well, how could there be 100% on the SOA, but then not 100% on the DPR? And there's a very simple answer to that. So in the actual DPR, a large portion of the DPR in instruction and program is related directly to student achievement test scores. The SOA does not include student achievement or test scores. It includes more operational, systemic, organizational processes. So that's really the difference between the two. So this is the SOA that's being presented. It's presented to the Board of Ed every single year, okay? If we turn to the DPR, just to give the board a little background, CUSAC is broken up into the following categories. There's instruction and program, there's fiscal management, there's governance, there's operations, and there's personnel. Those are the areas that we actually go through for the district performance review. We submit these scores, we upload these scores to the Department of Ed, they keep those scores, and then what happens is the county office sets up an appointment with the district, usually happens sometime around January or February, and then the county office will go through every component in the DPR and for CUSAC, and they will also give a set of scores. So that's the reason why if you see online, you'll see district scores on one side that are filled in, and then county scores that are not filled in. It is possible, because I've actually seen it both ways over the years, that district scores can either be increased by the county office or they can be decreased by the county office. School districts will potentially give themselves higher amounts of points on the district performance review, and then when the county comes in, if they do not see evidence, they will take points away from the district. There are also times when the district will score themselves almost at a brutally honest level, and when the county office comes in, they will say, maybe you're being a little too hard on yourself, pull out this evidence or this data and let's look at that. And sometimes they'll actually give the district additional points. And it is that score that's actually calculated and counted on your overall CUSAC results, okay? So with that being said, the one area that I do want to focus in on the DPR, just to make sure that everyone is understands and is comfortable, is in instruction and program. So I handed out something that looks like this to the board members. It's color-coded, and it's a history of CUSAC in the district, okay? So this history of CUSAC in the district gives all of you the scores from the first CUSAC that was ever done, which was 1 year after a pilot in 2008, okay? That was the original CUSAC. So at the end of this report, I tried to give you a graph that shows you longitudinal data in each of the categories. So in terms of instruction and program, or we'll even start with the fiscal category, you can see that in 2007-2008, the district started with a 41% in the fiscal category, and in 2013-2014, it increased to 95%, and then in 2016-2017, the score is 96%. In operations, we have gone from 83% in 2007-2008 to 100%. And operations consists predominantly of the school facilities checklist, and there are some other operational issues, but predominantly in that area. Personnel category has gone from 80% in 2007-2008 to 100%. The governance category has gone from 33% to 86%. Now, the one point that I want to make so that we're transparent, in 2013-2014, you will see 100% in governance. So you might say to yourself, why do we go from 100% in governance in 2013-14 to 86% in 2016 and 17. There's one category that the county office will most likely change when the evaluation of both the superintendent and the board are completed. I couldn't give points in this area yet, but when the county office comes for their review, my inclination is that those numbers will change. And then in terms of instruction and program, let's tackle this now so that we have a better understanding of what's going on. In 2007-2008, the district scored 34% in the area of instruction and program. In 2013-2014, the district scored 45%. Now, you might say, well, how is that possible? We're seeing in different documents 75% or 76%, et cetera. So what I tried to do in this small board document for you is to trace the interim reviews. So what happened in 2013-2014, where you see the original score of 45%? The county office came back and did its first interim review and increased that score based on progress that the district made to 75%. Then the county office came back one more time and did a second interim review and gave the district one additional point, raising it to 76% in its last review. Now, you might say, well, why is it only 76%? Where are the other points? The other points are directly related to student achievement test scores. So what happens is when you do and fill out the DPRs, some of the scores are already there for the school district. They are unchangeable. So the Department of Ed creates the spreadsheet. They have the spreadsheet ready for the district, and those scores are already populated by the Department of Ed. So they do that so that districts can't optimistically think that they're going to be able to look at their scores maybe in a little bit of a different way. The Department of Ed puts those scores right out there. Now, the really interesting thing, though, that I think is really important is that the 76% encompasses virtually every the difference between 76% and 100%, I should say, encompasses the test score piece. So the district at 76% in 2015-16 obtained virtually all the points it possibly could obtain. It couldn't go higher than that because the what the state uses as the test score benchmark for this DPR doesn't change. It stays the same. So it makes sense that the district would go from 45 or whatever it might be up, and then it hits a ceiling. It can't go any higher than that. Okay. So now we get to 2016-2017, and you're looking at these numbers, and you might say, why 76%? Interestingly, the Department of Education has not yet calculated the growth percentages for PARC. And so as a result, the instruction and program category for the 2016-2017 DPR for the CUSAC is based on 2013-2014 test data, the same data from the last CUSAC report. That doesn't change. Unless you're a district that falls into the next cohort, that's when Park will begin to count. Okay? So we're still operating off of NJ Ask and HESPA data. So that's that. What they have given us as advice is to footnote that to make sure that the community understands that that's what that's based on. So what will happen with us when we report this because of that test data, and that test data has not changed, we will then go through another interim review. That interim review will take place next school year. And then the question would be, will they then go and use the 2 years of Park or 3 years of Park? I can't say yes or no, I don't know. All I do know is that when they populated this, Park scores were not official and completely done, so they could not do the growth between NJ Ask and Park as a comparison, so they reverted back. So that's what this is based on. It sounds a little bit counterproductive, but that's kind of what it is. So we do look forward to the county office coming in after sometime in January, they said, to do the meeting with us for a lot of reasons, because this time around, I'm kind of excited about the fact that we'll be able to show them our new lesson plan design, the reporting of the lesson plans, both in written form and also digitally at that point, new observation process online with a new system, curriculum, as well as the drive that has the curriculum loaded on it. In addition to that, our data dashboard and some of the new programs. So I'm excited to have them come in. Unfortunately, I will tell you, it's still not going to change that particular numeric value. That stays. So that's what we have for CUSAC.
I imagine there might be some questions.
Yeah.
Last time we started this, anybody on this side?
Dr. Johnson, I'm just a little confused with the timetable here. So the district receives the final scores for last year's CUSAC in what month?
So there are no final scores for last year's CUSAC because there was no CUSAC last year. What there was an a visit, an interim review. That's what happened. So the official CUSAC scores, okay,
that the state gives us,
and it depends. It depends, okay, because, like, for example, I don't know as far back as 2007, 2008, but in 2013, 2014, depending on when the county office came, I don't know if they came in October, if they came in November. I'm not sure because I wasn't here then. And the letter from the county office doesn't reflect the time that they came. It reflects the time that the Department of Ed issues the letter. So it could be 8 months, 9 months later that they actually issue the letter.
But the Department of Education issues a letter to the county, which then issues it to the district? And that normally comes in the summer, or?
Usually sometime in the mid to late summer, based upon a visit the previous fall.
But those, like you just said, those are not the final results, the final scores, because there was all of these interim reviews in.
Correct.
So you couldn't really report on any of this until you had the close to final results, even though these aren't the final results. I see. And then I think on the agenda tonight, we have the, passing whatever scores we do have tonight, 9.23. And I'm just curious, I think that you set up a nice Excel sheet as backup to how you're going to, increase the score for curriculum and instruction. And I'm not sure if you want to go over it with the public or if you don't, I don't know. It's up to you.
Can you repeat?
So in the backup for 9.123 tonight, which is the CUSAC report, I think you wrote an action plan almost of how to increase the curriculum and instruction score, because it is at 76% and passing is at 80%, correct? Mm-hmm. And I don't know if you want to release, say anything about that to the public or not.
So no matter what, our action plan includes everything from systems that are in place for instructional improvement, curricular improvement, and also for very specific interventions for student achievement, as well as extensions and expansions for student achievement. So despite the fact that the 76% will not change, there's still an action plan that's in place to ensure that we are moving forward. We just won't see the results of any of that in the first interim review. But our action plan does include everything from overhauling the lesson design process to working a very specific curriculum overhauling process, as well as ensuring that our staff members are fully aware of and understand the specifications that are associated with the testing program that we're required to have. It also includes the rolling out of a very strong authentic literacy approach within the district. So I do know that the writing creates a little bit of anxiety for some, but yet it's getting much easier for others. And I think I said this last year, but in particular this year, the level of rigor associated with the writing and the reading components in the district is extremely expanded from what I saw when I first got here. So we all know that expanded initiatives in the area of reading and writing, particularly improvements in writing and reading, also will show effects in the area of mathematics, because the math tests are so language oriented now. So as an action plan, we are rolling out our process of authentic literacy tasks in the district. We have also implemented a new RTI program, which is a response to intervention program for children who are exhibiting some fragility in the area of areas of numeracy and literacy. So we have done that. And we are also expanding school day programs, so embedding some not just homework help anymore, but more tutoring components within our expanded school day process. So we are very hopeful that we are already beginning to see the fruits of that labor from a student achievement perspective.
Thank you. And just a follow-up question. You said that the instruction and the programming score of 76% will not be changed, but the governance score might be changed, correct?
Yes.
But I find it funny that they'll change one score, but not
because the test, what they're using that data for isn't, or basing it on, will not change.
Gotcha. Okay.
But it is possible that when they come and do the interim, they will have enough years. They'll have the data from PARC to be able to see that. Now, some of you sitting at the table might say, "Yes, but we reported out on PARC data, our PARC scores in the initial year were not very strong." And I say this all the time, you know, the work that we're doing, there's only one way for student achievement to go, and that's up. It's going to continuously increase and continuously improve. The way CUSAC is done is that it's based upon growth. So for us, we do want to see what it looks like when they're actually comparing PARC year one to PARC year three, or PARC year two to PARC year three. That's something that would be important for us.
Thank you.
How seriously should these CUSAC scores be taken? I mean, the state has their own criteria, but how much does it really relate to what's going on? So for example, we dropped in governance. I don't see a difference in governance. The instructional program is partially based on test scores. So suppose our kids did great, would the CUSAC scores then go up? Mm-hmm. I mean, the point is, the instructional part is confounded by the actual test scores, which CUSAC is trying to predict that there should be good test scores. If that doesn't make sense, let me say it again. Suppose everybody did well on the test, or whatever test they use, but we had the same instructional program in place, we would have a great CUSAC score. But suppose we did the exact same behaviors, but the test scores weren't high, we'd have a poor CUSAC score in instruction, right? That's how it works? So what really are the CUSAC scores telling us about our instructional program, other than that is this component of how well our kids are doing? In other words, is CUSAC just some sort of state boondoggle that really doesn't say much? It's a question. That could have an answer, actually.
Well, I don't have an answer, but I'll tell you, as I've been struggling to understand CUSAC, it was an attempt by the state nearly 10 years ago to try to make sure that every district in the state was adhering or striving towards some common standards. If in the instruction and program, if we looked at the areas that you get scored in, some of it, I don't know off the top of my head, but it's things like, is there a lesson plan on file for every class? So, and if you pull it out and go like, yes, here it is, you get 5 points. And then it sort of, it just goes through a whole litany of questions. And then it comes to the final one, which is test scores. If X number of kids scored above a certain, proficient or below proficient or advanced proficient, you get X number of points. If this next category, you get 8 points or 7 points or 6 points. So you can improve certain areas. You can, the review of CUSAC in your second year, they come in and you'll say, okay, look, now we have lesson plans on file.
Except we have
I'm just making this up.
Yes, but we've earned all the points in those areas.
Yes.
That is
we've maxed
kind
out
of
everywhere.
Our
but we're still stuck with the test scores from 2012, 13, 14. So we just have to wait. It's complicated. And I mean, the lesson that I've learned is that it's not like the state is coming in and saying, you guys get a 76%, for your instruction and program. It's the result of a whole bunch of factors, some of which we've fixed and some of which we're looking forward to fix. There's no one here on this board, I think, who's happy with the 76.
I just think you're confounding the result of our, with your criterion. And I mean, there's a lot of history with that 45% we got in instruction in 2014. And that had more to do, I believe, with personality conflicts than with anything in terms of our instructional. In other words, when you confuse the criterion, I'm sorry, when you confuse a predictor with a criterion and add them together, I'm not really that moved by the great score or the poor score. Mm. But what do I know, okay?
I agree.
Well, it was simply the state's way of trying to make sure that 600 districts throughout the state are doing something, to meet some kind of standards.
Okay.
Right. Any other questions? Mark, John? Does that conclude your superintendent's report?
Okay. Sorry.
Anybody in the mood for other committee reports?
Is it business measure?
I'm sorry, business.
I have two quick items. One, as board secretary, we are in receipt of a filed order to open and check results of a voting machine that was provided by the Hudson County Council. And what does this mean is, as a board of education, we're just notified that the results are going to be rechecked in the sense that one of the machines they'll be rechecking. So the fact that we do have a school board election involved with the general election and on November 8th, there was good cause presented to the Superior Court of New Jersey. And there is one, there are several in the county, but only one in Hoboken. It's Ward 3, District 7. So it is ordered that the voting machines be rechecked and people, meaning candidates and interested parties that want to be part of the viewing can attend. And the votes will be checked and the cartridges will be removed at that time. So again, they just wanted to notify us as the Board of Education. So that's the first item for tonight. Second item will be the under resolution 10.07 tonight, we have an amount of $8,320 for the Hoboken Police Department. This purchase order is still under review in my office, so I may present a higher number at the next board meeting. Just wanted you to know that, but right now I would still encourage you to consider the action as presented and to be revisited potentially in December. So I just wanted to advise the board of that as well. So that concludes my report.
Stop. We're going to vote for this, and if you raise it, you'll write up a new one, or and we'll.
That is correct.
This one will.
Yes, that'll take place. Right, we'll increase the existing one.
Cancel that.
Yeah, we'll just.
We'll
just increase the first order. Yes. Just so the board knows, this is a reoccurring every year. We do the fall sports. We do the winter sports. You're looking at the winter sports today. And we'll revisit that again every season.
Thank you, Mr. Moffitt. You know, I was going to do a curriculum and athletics committee report. I filled in for Dr. Gold and took notes. The only items on the agenda that have to do with curriculum and athletics is the Library of District Plans, which we reviewed. I know there's been some discussions back and forth with some board members, but I think those questions are being answered, and the committee did take a look at that and recommend it. I was going to report on the Professional Development Day, done. Passport for Learning, done. Cyber Patriots, done. CUSAC, done, and athletics, done. Thank you very much. That would get us to communications. You wanted to say something, Ellie?
Yes, we didn't have a communications meeting this month, but Jennifer Evans and I attended the Hoboken High School Student-Based Youth Center Community Liaison Board meeting. So that's actually one of my favorite committees. People from around the community come and we go sit in the student center and discuss issues that relate to teenagers or Hoboken High School teens, specifically students. Two of the things that were discussed, one of them was Challenge Day, and that's a national program where facilitators come and they lead the students in lots of exercises, kind of getting to know each other and breaking down barriers, kind of a bonding exercise. It's really a very moving and powerful experience. It takes the whole day. And this year there were two, one for the high school students and one for the middle school. So that was a nice discussion. And then another one we discussed was the personal growth period in Hoboken High School, which is a 90-minute sort of a free period that, and the students get to choose between a wide variety of academic, enrichment, athletic, creative activities. And each month or week, I believe, they're given a chart like this. And every day, they can choose to visit with college counselors, go to AP tutoring labs. They can go to the gym and do Zumba, yoga, swimming, basketball. God, there's so many. Chess, go to the editing studio, the chorus, the aquaponics farm, garage band. So every day there's different things that they can choose from. So that was kind of interesting to have a discussion like that with the community members. So I just wanted to report on that. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Biancamano, you have a facilities report.
I certainly do. The Facilities Committee met on Wednesday, November 2nd from 7 to 8.05 p.m. in Mr. Callaghan's office. In attendance were Mark McNamara, Sharon Angley, Jennifer Evans, myself, Mr. Callaghan, and Dr. Johnson. The items discussed. There were no facilities requests this month. we discussed the JFK Stadium final payment. The project is complete after some changes needed to be made to the track. The final amount should be on the agenda or a future agenda. The total amount is less than $900,000 in principal. The new backstop should be purchased in February. JFK Stadium restrooms. Minor repairs have been done. We are going to budget $200,000 from our capital improvement funds to completely gut the bathrooms and build them back up after the football season. I know many people are happy about that. We are also going to use $10,000 for a replacement of the concession stand. The field house completion project, the completed field house, should hopefully be funded by a booster club. We discussed Hoboken High School auditorium upgrades and what the status is. The sound system is finished, acoustic panels are in, carpets will be installed in about a week and a half, the curtains are up, 24 seats are going to be replaced. Everything should be completed by the first week of December before the first show. The ambulance donation, I know Ms. Angley will touch on this in her finance report, the ambulance donation to the Hoboken Volunteer Ambulance Corps. The old EMT ambulance has been out of service the past few years. After one of the Hoboken volunteer ambulances was in an accident, we loaned them ours. We have decided to donate it completely to the EMT program, to the Hoboken volunteer program, as our EMT program is now defunct. The sound system at Brandt, the final installation of the sound system is installed. This was paid for by a donation of $50,000. The POSHA, or the P-E-O-S-H-A inspection at Hoboken High School, a surprise inspection occurred. One or two minor items needed to be addressed, nothing major. Inspections can occur without notice, but we were certainly prepared for it. The Demarest boiler in this building. A new boiler was installed last year, but the second boiler is now defunct. It died out on us. We are confident we can get through the winter, and people know from being in here in the summer, with one boiler. So, but we do have an application with the School Development Authority to fast track payment for to replace the second boiler. And one quick note, overall technology was discussed. All grant money was used for upgrades. It's always better to lease technology in the hopes it won't get outdated. A new technology plan, which I believe is on tonight's agenda, is coming out, and like I said, it is on tonight's agenda, and it needs to be approved by the board. So that's all for this month, Mr. President. Thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Angley, Finance Committee.
The Finance Committee met on Wednesday, November 9th at 8:30 a.m. In attendance were Dr. Johnson, Mr. Moffitt, Mr. Klipfel, Mr. McNamara, and myself. The committee reviewed all agenda items and recommend all for board approval. I don't think I need to go into any further detail on the ambulance. I've got that covered. Other items we discussed were our annual audit that is now complete, and the committee will most likely be meeting with the auditors at the December committee meeting. We will also discuss with them the unpaid lunch balance, which I've previously mentioned, to see what their opinion is on the amount that is bad debt and should be written off. On the food service topic, we discussed sending out a survey to parents to get their feedback on quality and offerings. And we also have the profits from September, which is $300. Let's see, lease purchase. The Commissioner of Education approved the ground lease of $450,000. So, and that was closing last week, so I assume that happened at this point. We reviewed the CUSAC financial components, and we also discussed including a finance section in our overall strategic plan for the district. And that is it.
Thank you. That leads us to governance. Ms. Evans.
The Governance and Personnel Committee met on November 9th from 6 to 7:30. In attendance were myself, Ms. Montgomery, Ms. Sobolov, Mr. Klipfel, and Dr. Johnson. We reviewed all agenda items for tonight, and we recommend all for approval. A few items generated some questions and discussion. I'll go over those. On item 9.02, you'll see that we have two retirements on the agenda, Concepcion Arce and Sharon DeBerry. I did want to point out that Ms. DeBerry was with the district for over 26 years. We'd like to thank both of them for their service to the district and its students, and we wish them all the best in their retirement. Item 9.12, you'll see that we've got some exciting events coming up for our students. The high school will be hosting Hudson County Theater Day. Students attend two workshops, and they choose from workshops led by the four presenters that are listed on the agenda. The Drama Club is funding a workshop that will be led by actress Elaine Bromka, and this is in preparation for scenes and monologues that they will be performing at upcoming competitions. And finally, thanks to our local ShopRite, they'll be offering a nutritional program focused on healthy eating and food choices to our third graders at Wallace School. This is the third year of the program, and it wraps up each year with a trip to ShopRite. And also, at item 9.14, we have a volunteer who will be helping out with some reorganization in the high school library, so we wanted to extend our gratitude for that. And that concludes my report for tonight.
Thank you. I have no president's report other than two quick announcements. One, in the spirit of celebrating our students, to acknowledge our eighth grade middle school student, Ariana Santiago, whose essay, Veterans Day essay, was awarded first place, her essay about her Uncle Felix, who was a Vietnam veteran. And also, Hoboken High School defeated Brearley in a first playoff game last Friday night, and we are now awaiting, I think we're going into a semifinal game. Last I checked, the game was unannounced. It's going to be at a neutral site someplace on Friday. I don't know where it is yet.
It hasn't been announced.
Okay,
yet.
All right.
I think it's at Week Week.
Well, they play Week Week, right?
But, yeah, it's at Week Week. Week Week High School. I know it.
I think it's fair to say we're all excited and about that and cheering on our Red Wings. Any comments about questions about the committee reports?
I do,
yes.
Mr. President. I was just curious, Ms. Angley touched up upon this in her finance committee report. We're going back now to the food services debts, and I know that the auditor, I believe, is recommending that we pay it off ourselves instead of collecting debts, if I'm not mistaken?
So I've mentioned this a few meetings ago. So we have a balance. Some relates to, not last year, but the year before, under the old food service provider. Some relates to last year. Last year, there was a big effort to figure out why this was accumulating. And what the administration found was that in many cases, maybe there was a family who was eligible for free and reduced lunch, yet they only enrolled one child. So therefore, there may be other siblings not getting that benefit, but not paying for lunch as well. So in that case, there's a fine line of what can be collected and what can't, and that's what we'll discuss with the auditors. But because we know what led to some of the debt buildup, this year should be much smoother.
Well, and I'm just a little nervous every time I see that we're going to cover debts for uncollected lunches. I mean, we were $300,000, $400,000, $500,000 in debts a few years ago, mainly because a good chunk of it was because of uncollected debts when it comes to the food service provider. So I guess we'll see what the auditor has to say. I mean,
well, and this is for 2 years worth of time, about $40,000.
I just don't want to get into the habit of saying, you know, we're going to pay for uncollected debts in the future.
Yeah, and I don't want to either. But I think at some point there's things that can, and we did collect between $10,000 and $15,000 or $20,000.
Right.
So, you know, there will be some of that money that we will still pursue, and others that will need to be written off.
Okay. All right. I look forward to hearing.
Okay.
Thank you.
Anybody else?
No. In that case, it would be time for public comment on agenda items. While Mr. Moffitt is getting on, I just want to get into the habit of doing this. I skip it. Just the speakers are asked to abide by the guidelines for public participation. Speakers are allowed 5 minutes to make their statement. Please direct comments to the chair, and please refrain from directly addressing or questioning any administrator or other board member. Other than that, as long as any remarks are decorous and appropriate. Do we have any speakers?
Yes, we have two listed. The first speaker listed tonight is Pat Waiters for agenda items only.
Excuse me, this is not part of my 5 minutes. I address the board in its entirety just because I record the meetings for quality assurance purposes. Patricia Waiters, 1233 Park Avenue. The administrators, you're part of the agenda, right? Agenda items, the administrator's report?
Yes, as
okay, item number,
board secretary?
Yes, you added number, item number one, the school board lawsuit, I mean, the school, the election lawsuit, and I mean, the reviewing of the machines, and resolution number 7 for the Hoboken Police Department. I didn't get clarification on what resolution number 7.
10.07, if I can.
Yeah, 10.
Mr. President? Mr. President, may I address?
10.07.
Yeah. Want me to respond?
I'm just.
I mean, you can respond later however you want. I just want to make sure it's added on the agenda.
Yes, that okay. Item I referenced, 10.07, is on the agenda tonight. Right.
All right. And plus item number one, you just said school board election. Did you receive something from the county board of elections? So that's going to be listed as item number one.
Well, that's not necessarily a resolution. That was just part of my report to
just
the board,
report.
Saying that as board secretary, I received notification from the Hudson County clerk.
All right, I'll list it as notification. Thank you. Okay, with that being said, page 9-21, resolution 9.11. I'm glad the annual district electronic violence and vandalism report. But I'm so glad, Dr. Johnson, you went into full detail, because parents asked me this too. This electronic violence vandalism report is actually all of the data is entered into a computer, because parents is receiving letters randomly, so this will definitely help explain. I want to thank you myself too, because I received one, and a few other parents. This is excellent, because if you see a pattern or whatever of parents getting this letter at home, we hope they could do something about it versus it getting really blown out of proportion. And I like what you said about there's no such like calm versus aggressive or whatever. And I hope it's added in this, from picking up a pencil, tossing it, tossing a chair, whatever, out of anger. That goes for all the students, whether you're in the kindergarten, the preschool program. All of them is listed in this report, I hope, not just the high school, because the high school is not the only one where we have these issues. I've witnessed it myself in the courtyard. Some of them little kids could be very aggressive, and they is in a kindergarten in first grade. So I'm glad you went into detail with that. And now with the added agenda items, the school board election, I'm glad this, I'm gonna just clarify this a little bit, because I was a candidate. The way this goes with the counting of the machine, Mr. Cogliotti, counsel, you can correct me if I'm wrong, it's not only for people that ran, right? It's not only for the candidates. Members of the public can come and witness and verify the machine count, am I right? Okay, because me being a candidate and a board member, I mean, a board worker that day, I always get this letter, because sometimes it's randomly, but it's followed by a complaint. And me as a citizen, I was not a candidate this time, but you said Ward 3, I want to make sure I'm precise, Ward 3, District 7, because I worked in a Ward 3, but there's no District 7. So maybe it's a misprint. However, I had a problem, and I'm glad this is made publicly, because people that's watching this could witness that I didn't run. So I feel the same way. I feel cheated every time I see an election where this type of thing have to take place, regardless to who it is. And the report, to get a report like this, this is embarrassing. Because a complaint is filed first, and this is how you get your machine open, because of suspicions. I had to confiscate voters' material, and people watching this, I hope they really come out for this date. So give the date too when I finish speaking, because I noticed you didn't say what date the machine's gonna be count. I was a worker, and I confiscated material. There's rules and regulations, policies you go by, and voters' laws. And be careful when you go run and take a complaint out on somebody when you're doing something illegal. I confiscated voters' material on my third ward, and being that you mentioned third ward, this is why I'm speaking on this issue on the agenda. And it's mind-bothering, because then you sit there with these straight faces, and I hope after the count is done, I'm going to come back to the same microphone and bring it up. Stop running for the board, because it's about ethics. It's about loyalty. You're running to serve kids, okay? And this doesn't look nice. That election was horrible. It just shows how hard up people are for power and control, because when you win, you don't focus on our children. And I refuse, I mean it, to keep telling you this. I'm not bringing politics in this school system. So don't sit up there with the blank faces like, oh no, we follow the rules, and you don't. Because this lawsuit right here says it all. And I want to thank you, Dr. Johnson, so much the way you exclude yourself. And thank God we finally got a superintendent that is not political. And I've seen that, because you see me outside walking the deck. It's not fair to our student. It's not fair to our school district. And this has been going on for centuries, so I'm not placing the blame at nobody. Go as far back as you want, but yes, this is all political, and we gotta stop. Please, everybody watching this, please come out that day for the counting of the machine and bring your complaints, because I'll be submitting mine. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other speakers?
I would just like to address, she wanted me to confirm the ward and district. So the document I have, it shows Hoboken Ward 3, District 7, and that as she stated, all interested parties may be present at that recounting by the county clerk. So that's just what I wanted to clarify.
Thank you.
And the last item I would just want to interject is that, remember everyone in attendance tonight and the board, that we do not run these elections, the school board elections. They're actually controlled and administered by the Hudson County Clerk's Office. So it's something they run, and they're just advising us of this issue and just putting us on notice. That's it.
Right, it's not aimed specifically at the Board of Education. It's the no. machine in that district for the national election.
Correct.
Everything, yeah, okay. Just confirming the votes. Are there any other speakers, Mr. Moffitt?
The next speaker is Brian Murray.
Good evening, Brian Murray, 1100 Maxwell Lane. Dr. Johnson, in the past, when some of these very complicated reports were given, sometimes there would be a slide presentation or handouts for people in the audience to be able to follow along. Maybe in the future that could happen, because I tried to follow along and I got about half of it, so I'll take it at your word on that. My questions revolve around agenda item 9.16, which is the hiring of all of the coaches for the winter session. Is there a document or a formula that can be laid out for the public that can understand how we arrive at not only the salaries but also the complicated formula in terms of deciding that we have a head coach of boys swimming and a head coach of girls swimming, and yet one assistant that covers both the boys and the girls, and then some other sports we have a head coach of boys basketball, and we have three assistant boys basketball coaches, and that's four people for, I don't know, maybe 15 kids versus, and maybe it could be the junior varsity and whatever else, but some breakdown that makes sense as to why the boys basketball head coach gets paid almost double of what the rest of the coaches get. That would be helpful for us. And then the last item I have is the cost of transportation. Maybe there could be some clarity given, most of the time I just look at this and go on, but some things just struck me. The most egregious of it is the transportation to the New Jersey PAC, where you have all of these pre-K students going, which is a great thing, but my math says that it's about $100 a head to transport the kids to the New Jersey PAC. That's based on how many kids you have there and what you're listed. It seems to me that we could rent limos for them and take them versus buses at that price. I'm not sure why, 14 kids, are the cost to the district is $1,400 for the New Jersey PAC. Just as, some of the other things like taking five middle school students to what seems to be a bowling alley for whatever purpose seems to be almost $90 as a cost per transportation to the district. And I'm not sure as an accounting issue as to whether we just have these, we have this transportation just sitting idle, and then when we use it, we kind of charge against it. And so there really is an extra cost, or whether it's a direct bill to maybe a third party or something to that effect. But, you know, we're looking at costs of running $85 to $100 a student for these. And kind of what's the guideline in terms of where do we say enough is enough on some of these things and say, hey, you know, if it's above $40 or $50, then, you know, we as a board or you as a board are going to say, hey, you know, maybe we need to find a more cost-effective way of doing that. Thank you.
Thank you. Get to the second. Is there any other speakers?
No, that was it. That was just the two speakers.
Dr. Johnson, would you like to clarify that?
Yeah, and I think we could probably do a better job the way that we present maybe the transportation and the trips on the agenda. So where you see $1,400 in multiple times, it's not for $1,400 for that one group of 13 children. It's for the entire group that's actually going. That's why it's repeated multiple times. Maybe it probably would be better if we just put it one time and listed all the classes that were a part of it. So the cost actually isn't that. It's the way that it's listed out there and presented does give the impression that it's for each class, but it actually isn't.
I have a question with the agenda. With the Harvard Model Congress, is that $1,416 per person or for the total?
That one is actually $400. I think, Ms. McQuillan, do you have that number for me? We kind of anticipated that question.
I will get my hearing aids in a few days, so please talk loudly. And.
Yeah, so the student cost, it's $400.
Not $400 per person?
Yeah, not 14 something. And the kids do some fundraising, et cetera, for that
so
as well.
So each student has to pay $400. And as a total, the district has to pay $13,000.
Correct.
And how is the money, how many students are there?
How many students attend?
Are going to be going to the Congress?
I'll tell you in 1 second. Yeah, I think there's 13 students. Tell you in 1 minute. You know what? Liz, do you have that back up?
Yeah.
How many people voting against this?
12, Dr. Gold.
12. So $4,800 are going to be raised by the students, right? Mm-hmm. And is this was the money raised as a group, or is each kid having to come up with that money?
No, so there are some group fundraisers, and the remaining cost, the child actually covers the cost.
Okay, so the total trip is about $18,000, and the students as a group were only able to raise $4,800 of it. Okay.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions?
If it's an agenda item, I wanted to pull it, but I guess I can just go.
Well, I was going to. Dr. Gold has asked a question there, but I was going to say now would be the time to ask for a motion on the consent agenda, and then we can discuss.
Can I pull something?
Yeah.
Motion.
Motion
second.
From Sharon. Second from Irene. Irene.
Can I pull something off to be voted separate, just because I want to discuss it before people vote on it?
Please.
10.5.
Which is bills and claims.
finish yet?
Go now?
No, is that...
Yeah, that's the only one I want to pull off so we can vote separately because I want discussion before we vote on it.
Fine.
I have one question, but I don't have to pull it off.
You have a question?
I have a question, but I don't need to pull it off. I just...
Okay. So we have a consent agenda, but holding off on 10.5.
I think it's 10.05, right?
I'm sorry.
Bills and warrants?
10.05.
Okay, sorry. Then if we're ready, we can... Mr. Moffitt, you call a vote?
Well, no. Yeah. I'm going to ask a question.
Oh, you have a question.
Right. I'm sorry. I'll listen to that. 10.07, the approval of contracts. AE, which is the contract to Hoboken University Medical Center for medical services to students. I was just curious, could any students use this service up until the amount is spent? Anybody?
Well, this is a purchase order basically covering special education related services. Gotcha. So the students we would normally send for evaluation would be part of an IEP process and require that type of evaluation. So that's really what it's limited to.
Nice. And it's not new. We've had this in the past.
Correct? Yeah, we do this every year. Yes.
It's curious. Thank you.
Okay. Now, call a vote.
Okay, consent agenda minus resolution 10.05.
Yes.
Ms. Angley?
Yes.
Mr. Biancamano?
No on all the minutes, 6.01, 02, and 03. Yes on everything else.
Ms. Evans?
Yes.
Dr. Gold?
No on 8.06, and I'm going to vote no on the Harvard Congress just because I still expect it to pass, so I want my cake and eat it too, but there's going to be a lot of events, and we just have to do more raising of money because what happens when people want to go to the Thespian Festival again in Nebraska, or somebody wants to go to the local science fair in Wisconsin. I just think that this number can add up and up, and we need a policy that lets us talk about how we fund these worthwhile, but I'm not sure if they should really come so much out of our budget. We're giving each kid $1,000 to do something worthwhile, but you know, I can think of a lot of other of our students that could find events that are appropriate for their career goals. So I'm going to say no for the Harvard Congress, and I'm going to say no for 8.06 of the technology plan, and I'm going to say yes for everything else. But we're not voting on 10.05, right? That's going to be different. Okay.
And a yes on all else, you said. Okay. Mr. Madigan?
Okay, I'll abstain on 6.01, 6.02, and 6.03 abstain. And yes on everything else. The minutes.
Okay. Mr. McNamara?
I'm going to abstain on 6.01. I wasn't on the board yet for those minutes. I'm going to vote no on 8.06 and all else yes. Thanks.
Ms. Montgomery?
I abstain from 6.03 and yes on anything else.
Yes on all else.
Yes.
Ms. Sobolov?
I need to abstain on the field trips. My husband is taking the scenic design students to the ABC studios, to the View, and Dr. Oz to see the studios and the prop rooms. So yes on everything else and abstain on the field trips.
And Mr. Kofel?
Yes. Motion passes?
Yes, the motion passes.
Thank you. Then it's time for, 10.05.
Yeah. Okay. The reason I asked for Polis is when I looked at it during the day today, I saw there was an item 103 times parking reimbursement at $200 each. I spoke to Mr. Gagliardi, so if I go somewhere, Mr. Gagliardi, cut me off. You said everything's good, but if you notice, you tell me.
Yes, sir.
Okay?
Yes, sir.
So he sent Mr. Moffitt an email, what are all these charges? And he said it was a contract issue that we pay parking for employees that live out of Hoboken. So I asked him, was that put on this contract? And I was told, he said, no, it's been the last two contracts. Now my problem is, we're paying $20,000 tonight, $20,000 and $20,600 in parking. It's not going directly to the Hoboken Parking Utility, but it was for the Hoboken Parking Utility. So we're banging the taxpayers twice. Now, I remember when that contract, I wasn't on board, but I remember board members saying they were negotiating not to pay for these staff members with the Hoboken Parking Utility, but they never came back and said it was going to cost the taxpayers $200 for each staff member, that they did. Now, what makes me more mad is when we went to vote the last two contracts that while I was on the board for two different unions, we were rushed through that night by the person who's no longer here, Monica, who was in a witness protection program, I think, because she disappeared overnight. But we were rushed that night. We had to vote on it that night. Nothing was changing or else it was going to be a mess. This was never brought up, that this was there. Now, this is just tonight, $20,000 and $20,600. That's a big chunk of money. And we're got, now, I don't know why we're not sending it right to the parking authority. I don't know if it has to go some other way, if it's illegal that way, and we're backdooring it. But I feel it was really done in bad taste by board members who voted on that contract and never told the public that they were going to pay for people's parking. I pay for a parking sticker. No one pays for my parking sticker as a resident. Now, it's in the contract, there's nothing you can do, but I want the public to know this is out there. $20,000 tonight, not on education, $20,000. And I'd like this board, and Tom, maybe you could look into this. Anytime a contract for a union comes up, it cannot be voted, the MUA, that night when we're shown a piece of paper you can't leave the room with. You cannot take it home that night. We need to have more transparency for the board on contracts. And we didn't have it on my first two contracts. And we were rushed through them. And I think it's a disservice that was done to board members and on the residents of Hoboken. And that's my biggest problem is that I didn't even know what was in there as we were rushed through it. And Monica pushed that night and pushed us. And I feel it's an embarrassment that the contract before, from you go back and watch the tapes, board members said they were negotiating to get nothing, but not to pay for the staff members. But never came back and said we're paying $200 a staff member. Okay? So it has nothing to do with Mr. Moffitt on that issue, but he's following the contracts that were approved by board members. Okay? And I think they were done in darkness to the public. And that's my problem with this. Now, I don't know if it is legal that this is being paid. I guess it is because it's in the contract, but it makes me think there's something funny that we didn't just pay it right to the Hoboken Parking Utility. Okay? So that's all I want to discuss on that issue. I know we have to pay it because people before me did this and never told the public. That's all I want out there. So you can take the vote if no one else has anything to say.
Thank you. Do you have a motion now on 10.05?
Motion.
There's a chance after.
Ms. Evans' motion, is there a second?
Second.
Call the vote, please.
Ms. Angley?
Yes.
Mr. Biancamano?
Aye.
Ms. Evans?
Yes.
Dr. Gold?
I have to abstain, but it has nothing to do with what John said.
Did you get 200 from them?
Actually, I got 250 about that, so.
Mr. Madigan?
No.
Mr. McNamara?
Yes.
Ms. Montgomery?
Yes.
Ms. Sobolo?
Yes.
And Mr. Klopfel?
Yes. Motion passes. Yeah. And that brings us to public comments on agenda and non-agenda items. Are there speakers?
We have four speakers listed tonight. First one is Chris Adair.
Talk louder, please.
And congratulations on the new stadium. It looks great. The field looks great. I did speak with Richard Calvi, and he spoke a little bit about back office management and your definition tonight. So that's cool. Looking forward to having a larger backstop potential with this week tonight. I really appreciate the board kind of reacting and working with that as an association. So thank you for that. Tonight I just came to address a slightly different topic regarding the stadium, and that is that there's a lot of open parking that happens at the stadium during the weekend. And specifically, Saturday mornings when the little guys are out there practicing their football, and parents tend to queue up and double park there. And then also on other football nights, I think. And obviously, living in the neighborhood is a bit of a nuisance for the residents there. But I think what the board would be concerned about is that there's a safety issue. Just this weekend, I saw one of the buses pull up to load the kids in, and the bus was double parked on the street. It wasn't actually blocking the whole street, so there was still traffic going by, and the kids actually were kind of loading in on the bus. And it's kind of a hassle. The games come out, or the practice lets out, the kids are kind of filtering out onto the streets, and traffic is sort of going by. I do know that there's a driveway that's to the north of JFK Stadium where a lot of school buses are. So typically they tend to be sitting there. I don't know if that's something that the board might want to look at for game days or practice days to kind of at least let the kids board in and out of the buses in that driveway. And then as far as just kind of trying to encourage parents to not go park, to either find parking or get alone in the challenge, we all face it in this town, or to walk, or to go for a bike, or do something, you know, kind of along the safe routes, safe streets, kind of go through all the work in the city. So anyway, that would be my feedback. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
One thing, if I could say just, I know it's not us, but maybe someone could pass it on to the recreation or the police department, because it is, that's a recreation thing on the weekends, but also the police for a safety issue, whatever.
Yeah, we have been. We actually agreed to kind of serve as a bit of a liaison to help both pass the message on to the coaches and the organizers of the league, and also with the police. So what happened this past weekend or the weekend before was exactly, or last weekend, what is exactly what we had hoped would happen. I was notified by the police department and City Hall. We then took that information, went through the athletic department, and then through the Pee Wee or Junior Football League. But we'll continue to do that for safety purposes.
Next speaker, Ms. Moffitt.
Next speaker is Pat Waiters.
I'm sorry, that parking just knocked me off focus, because you're going to need somebody with some good magic. Pat Waiters, 1233 Park Avenue. I have here tonight a proclamation from the county of Essex, New Jersey. The Essex County Board of Chosen Freeholder, President Eugene Drayton from the NAACP. And this proclamation I'm presenting to the business administrator, I spoke to you earlier on this, is for Dr. Johnson for her outstanding performances. I'll give it to the administrator. She was honored, one of the recipients of the 2016 Thurgood Marshall Education Award by the Hoboken National Branch, NAACP, and the National Organization of Black Law Enforcement Executive Nobles. She was honored on Friday, September the 30th at the W Hotel at the event. President Eugene Drayton couldn't be here tonight because there's a lot of chapters to have elections tonight for the NAACP. But I'm proud to present this to Dr. Johnson. And if you might, business administrator, could you take this? I will read it, but you know I'm a candidate and I don't want him to make it political. Eugene Drayton is our president of the NAACP and the other organizations that Mr. Moffitt have there.
Would you like for me to read it?
Yes, please.
Whereas Christine J. Johnson will be honored by the Hoboken branch of NAACP and the National Organization of the Black Law Enforcement Executives as recipient of the 2016 Thurgood Marshall Education Award, which will be held at Lulu's at the W Hotel in Hoboken, New Jersey on Friday, September 30th, 2016. And whereas Christine J. Johnson currently serves as superintendent of schools for the Hoboken School District, prior to arriving in Hoboken, she served as a superintendent for both the Mendham Township and Booton School Districts. Her leadership and vision helped both previous districts secure several accolades, including the National Blue Ribbon Award, two consecutive years of distinction as the National School Change Award finalist, a 2012 Innovations in Special Education Award, and high performing status through the NJ-CUSAC monitoring process. And whereas Christine J. Johnson holds an undergraduate degree in history and advanced degrees in modern European intellectual history, historical studies, and in educational leadership, she holds New Jersey certificates as teacher, supervisor, principal, and chief school administrator, superintendent. And whereas Christine J. Johnson is currently focused on the development of aspiring educational leaders, she has devoted much of her free time to mentoring and guiding graduate students during their internship experiences and as newly appointed principals and superintendents. And whereas Christine J. Johnson is proud of her previous work as a teacher, state championship varsity basketball and volleyball coach, content area supervisor, and assistant superintendent. Her experiences have shaped her current work as superintendent of schools in Hoboken, as they have taught her to always believe in the unlimited potential of each and every student. And whereas Christine J. Johnson served as an adjunct professor for Montclair State University Graduate School of Education. In 2013, she was nominated and recognized by the Morris County Council of Educational Associations as Educational Leader of the Year. Most recently, she was awarded Montclair State University's prestigious Allen Moorhead Memorial Award. And whereas Christine J. Johnson has delivered numerous keynote addresses and presentations for organizations across the state of New Jersey, including the New Jersey School Boards Association and the New Jersey Department of Education on topics related to student achievement and closing the achievement gaps that exist in schools across the country. Furthermore, she remains excited and committed to the transformative work that lies ahead in the Hoboken schools. Her passion for educational equality and excellence is unwavering. She believes the social, emotional, and academic growth of all children is non-negotiable. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the Essex County Board of Chosen Freeholders, hereby congratulate and commends Christine J. Johnson on the occasion of being named recipient of the 2016 Thurgood Marshall Education Award by the Hoboken branch of the NAACP and Noble. Congratulations.
Stay there.
Thank you, Business Administrator. That was my best 5 minutes ever. Thanks. Thanks a lot. I have nothing else to say. She's doing a wonderful job. We're so proud of you, Dr. Johnson. Thank you.
Next speaker listed tonight is Brian Murray.
Brian Murray, 1100 Maxwell Lane. I come up here and ask for a lot of things sometimes, and I missed this when I was talking about the agenda, but thank you very much. I see all the walking field trips are approved in one swoop, so thank you for that. I appreciate it. As far as, I'd like to address Mr. Madigan's comments about the parking for the teachers. I come to a lot of these meetings, and I do recall that that was discussed at one of these meetings, that the public was aware that there was parking, or at least it was on the table for parking. It confounds me that this is the one topic in terms of budget items that, you know, concerns you versus I come up here almost every month and talk about things in the agenda that you vote on that you approve that are just wasteful spending, whether it's JV scorekeepers, whether it's lunch, people are counting lunches, people are signing up pre-K at astronomical rates, and you want to talk about parking for teachers. And then the excuse for that is Monica forced me into it. You were elected here to be able to stand up for people and voice your own opinion, and for Monica railroaded me into the approving $200 for the teachers' parking. I mean, really, give me a break. But having said that, that wasn't what I was coming up here to talk about. I was coming up here because I probably won't attend the next meeting, but I did want to thank Mr. Leon Gold for his service as a school board trustee. We basically never saw eye to eye on any issue, but I do appreciate your dedication and your integrity in what you believed, even though it was not what I believed. So thank you for that, and hopefully you will advocate from the audience along with the rest of us. And and I hope that your replacement certainly has that $2 million brownstone, so we're not turning that seat over again. Just to make one last argument against your position, Mr. Gold, if I may, and that's the Harvard Model Congress. Voting against it, you may have principles and about the cost, and I understand where you're coming from. However, you know, it was simple enough that we voted for bowling and swimming tonight, and that's $20,500 for those sports that will serve a certain segment, and there's an awful lot of athletics that are already there, from basketball to football to track to whatever else you have there. And you know, this is an academic endeavor that I think should be supported maybe before athletics, to send a message to the community at large that academics are important. In fact, they're not just important, they're the number one priority, not the number two or three or five priority. So one last time, I respectfully disagree with you on your position there. My last point here is about the elections. During this election cycle, like many of the previous one, some of the city council members came out to support what would be considered the longstanding majority that's running the board right now. And that's well within their rights. What I want to know is, when are you going to ask them for new facilities? When are you going to demand of the city council and the mayor's office that we petition for new facilities? There was talk of a new high school many years ago, and you guys have been sitting here in power for year after year after year with the city council, with the mayor, with the school board, and we still have no new facilities. We don't have anything on the agenda for new facilities. What we're getting is a parking lot, and we're getting some flood mitigation. I want to know, how are you letting this happen? You have
control of the Board of Ed, you have control of the City Council, you have the Mayor's Office. If the three of those bodies can't get together and request some new facilities like every other town in Hudson County has, then, you know, what is your obligation? Do you not care about new facilities? Do you find that it's confounding to me that that agenda has not moved forward, and that every election is about the fear of the past and 10 years ago and the budgets and my people stealing money, instead of looking to the future and saying, we deserve new schools for our students, for our community. Thank you.
Thank you.
The next speaker is Roseanne Versace.
Yield. Okay.
Yield.
I just want you to know, the Board of Ed, what happens in the parking authority in Hoboken, what a teacher has to go through, okay? Because years ago, when we first started, we were paying $25 for the parking permit to be able to park on both sides, all right? Because if we're in the classroom, we can't come out to move the car if we're parking on the white side, which is 4 hours. So they started charging us $25, $100, $200. It is up to $300 actually to park on both sides. As employees of the city, basically what we are, the board members should get together and go up to the parking authority and the mayor and ask her, why is she charging us to park in the school, to park in this town? So not this contract, the contract before, and Vito was part of the last night, this was made very public of what was going on. We came to the table, Roseanne was part of it, and said we will not have a contract if we have to continue to pay for parking. We are not going to pay for parking any longer in Hoboken as employees of the Board of Education. Leon will back me up on this. He was on the board, and it became an issue. Why isn't there parking lots for us to park in like other districts? Why do we have a parking authority who seeks out our cars to give us, to boot the teachers and to give us a ticket? Teachers still can't go up there and pay. Now we pay $200. I negotiated with John Morgan, and now it's $200. But only certain teachers pay $200. They make a determination on who's going to pay $300 and who's going to pay $200. So if I teach in Hoboken, and I don't get the $200 permit, I'm supposed to park on the white side, but I'm only allowed 4 hours in the city. So I'd have to come down and move my car again, and I'm still breaking the law, really, because I'm only allowed 4 hours in the city. This is an issue in the town. When I address the teachers the first day, the new teachers, it's the first thing I bring up. I said, believe me, you're going to either get booted or get ticketed here once in your career. And it happens constantly. So, John, I respect how you feel, but you're way off base on this one. Let me just say one thing. Anyone that has negotiated with this administration, our leadership, nothing is behind closed doors. I think we're more upfront, and we tell people when we get started what we're looking for. That negotiations would have fell through if we didn't get the parking. I'm telling you right now, we were ready to walk out that night. Because it's ridiculous. You should be upset by it. Instead of paying us, we have to pay the $200, and then we ask the board to reimburse us the money back, which is part, they won't even accept it. They don't want to hear nothing. This is a monopoly they have. You should be upset that you have to pay the $20,000. And that's something, no, I know you are, but you should go up to City Hall and ask the mayor, and ask who refuses to see me, will not see me on the parking. Makes BS excuses of why she can't see me. And I'm not here to knock the mayor, but why do we have to pay $300 or $200 to park in the city where we're working? And I know people go to New York and pay, I understand all that, but we're public employees. So I just wanted to clarify that. Nothing, then Vito, I think, will back me up, was done behind closed doors. This was not no side deal. We were up front. Anyone that was in that meeting that first night said, look, we're not going to get a deal here tonight if we have to pay for the parking. So that's how the $20,000 came out. It's going to be more.
I'm telling you right now.
Can I respond? I never said nothing about your union. What I said is the board members never told the public. They said in the meeting, I never said nothing about your union. That's what you're
What, this past contract?
Please. No, the contract before.
Well, that I can't control what goes on the other side.
If you listen to what I said, what was said the past one, what was said the past one was when you were negotiating that they were negotiating, the Board of Ed was negotiating with the City Parking Authority to get it for nothing. They never came back and told the public.
Well, that's
what I said. I never said nothing about your union. You didn't.
No, you can say whatever you want. But
my complaint is that we're paying the City of Hoboken's Parking Authority.
And
that
that's something,
money, and, it's an
and I agree 100% with you. That's something that should be addressed by the Board of Education. Not the super, whoever wants to handle it, should go up and ask the mayor, why do we have to pay to park? And they pursue you. If you happen to forget, you know, the thing falls off your dashboard or something, there's a boot. You come out. It costs the teacher $350 to come to work. Robin's been booted how many times? About three or four? I mean, it's like a common occurrence. All right? I just wanted to clear it up about the parking.
Let's get up to the mayor.
Thank you, Gary.
We shouldn't be paying the city.
Right, let's get up to the mayor and talk about it.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Murray. The reason I am sincere, the reason I voted against the Harvard Model Congress, something I've been voting for 7 years, is that our students are going to become more and more involved in a number of other activities, such as last year we sent a number of students to the Thespian Festival. We should have sent them. It was a national championship, but there's going to become more and more events. And as the community becomes more aware of the opportunities for our students, we're going to reach the point where we can't afford to send everybody there. So that should be an opportunity for people to maybe as a community get together to try to fund a pool of money for the students or increase our fundraising. But if we're going to treat all our students equally and each of our students has a skill and a passion that we want to support, I think we need a mechanism to provide equally for our students. But please do not interpret this as some slight on the Harvard Model Congress, because it was one of the premier things we do give to our students. So I just wanted to clarify that. Nothing against Harvard Model Congress. Have a way of funding piecemeal student activities, though.
Thank you. Anybody else? Motion to close?
Motion to close.
Motion second.
What?
Yes. I was the last one.
I thought you yielded to Gary.
I yielded my spot. I'm sorry. It's going to be very quick. I just wanted to comment, Roseanne Versace, fourth grade teacher, Wallace School. I just wanted to comment on just two things real quickly. Last Tuesday, we had a professional development day. The students were out, and it was an all-day professional development day. And I know people always wonder what exactly goes on. And I won't get into all the nitty-gritty because it's late and people are tired, but I just want to end on a positive note. So the PD day started with a convocation by Dr. Johnson, and one of the things that she mentioned was having our backs, and I think that's an important message to convey to the teachers. We come under fire a lot. I don't think I need to talk about what education has become in the state of New Jersey and even nationally. So to know that our concerns are being heard and addressed, I think that's really important to the teachers, and it was a message that really resonated with everybody. Professional development was led in large part by administrators and our fellow teachers, and I think that was also a very positive step, because who knows better what the trenches are like than the people that are in the trenches. And I think there was a lot of good dialogue, and it was good just to be with everybody for the entire day. We even had lunch together, which is not what happens typically. So there was a real collaborative spirit, and overall, the teachers really appreciated that, and I think it makes us look forward to further PD down the road. So I just wanted to say that. Lastly, I just wanted to comment on two of the retirements. Sharon DeBarry, who has been a fixture in this district for 28 years, I think they said. She's been somebody that people have come to rely on in central office. And while we will miss her, we hope that she has an enjoyable retirement. And Rosangela Perez, a teacher from Wallace School who's taught special ed, Spanish, kindergarten, been resource teacher. She was also part of, she started the FLOOR program, which promoted spirited conversation and activities among girls from Hispanic backgrounds, recognizing and appreciating their ethnicity. So she was really, is really a special person, always had a smile on her face, and we wish her all the best in her retirement. It's a little bittersweet that she is leaving us, but we, like I said, we wish her all the best, and that's it. So thank you for letting me speak.
Thank you.
Motion to close.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.